want no Gatorade. I'm just telling you, I don't want none. I don't drink Gatorade. I drink Pepsi and water. Pepsi and water.
Are you ready for worship impact?
Yeah.
I said, are you ready for worship? stand where you are. And understand the goodness and the greatness of God. You see, he is awesome because he takes our broken pieces and makes them whole again. He is awesome because he provided us with food when we were hungry and didn't have anything in our refrigerator. Sacrifices on the God's Son. Oh my God. Let us pray. Most Heavenly Father, we come before you wounded in every single way. But God, we thank you for the healing that you have placed in our bodies. God, we thank you for being steadfast. For protecting us from the seen and from the unseen. God, if we had a thousand tongues, we wouldn't even be able to begin to praise you enough. So God, we simply say hallelujah and thank you for your presence in our lives. We thank you for strengthening us every single day. We thank you for forgiving us. We thank you for allowing us to overcome all of our trials and tribulations. God, we thank you for giving us through the fire. And we thank you for protecting us from the storm. Oh God, you are just so awesome. And we ask that you hear us now, God, as we come to you. Kneeling to the great I am. Kneeling to the Lord of all the kings of kings. Kneeling to the one true living God. Asking for you to touch all of your children, God, that are on the need of healing right now. Whatever the ailment may be, God, just touch them right now. Have your way with them. And God, we ask that you give clarity to those who may wonder or even ask. They have developed theories, they have developed conspiracies, but God, we know that you are the truth. We know that your word is a living word, and we know that you are a living God. So God, we ask for you to just touch them right now. And God, we live in a world that is against us. We live in a world that doubts you. Thank you. energy that God gave you to make them this morning. Amen. Amen. Just get excited about the Lord.
Amen.
At this time, we'd like to acknowledge all of our first-time visitors. If you are a first-time visitor to Impact Church St. Louis, we ask for you to stand where you are simply so we can acknowledge who you are. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Our company came with her a little bit early. So we have a friend that we've been asking for about a year to come and visit us, but hey, thank God you came to visit us. But, so to all of you, we all just simply warm and overwhelmed with your presence. We know that you could have gone anywhere to worship this morning, but you chose us, and we are thankful for that. We pray that you are a part of church because we all are part of Kingdom Building together. However, if the Lord leads you to join Impact Church St. Louis, we are a Bible-based church that loves the Lord.
Yeah, yeah.
And we will grow with you, we will love on you, and we will simply face this journey called life following the Lord. Amen?
Yeah.
Amen. You may be seated. And now, Impact. Like that. And now. Let's welcome Imprint Your Hands. Amen?
Amen.
You know, fear, doubt, and unbelief has a way of creeping in and stealing our faith from us. This is our spirit. Thank you.
You call your friends, they don't answer the phone. You call your mom, your dad, they probably sleep too. But it's somebody that's 24 hours. That you can call them anytime you want to call them. You can call them in the morning, you can call them at night. When you cry, he'll wipe away your tears. Some kind of sign. I got to see if you're rocking. If you're reminiscing about something, about what he has done in your life, you may not be where you want to be right now, but you're still better than what you were yesterday. You're still better than what you were 10 years ago. You might not be what you want to be, but thank God that you're not the same person that you were yesterday. It sounds like y'all know Jesus. Right now, Children's Church is open. /Eyes Up. You can see Miss Brooks in the back. She's carrying the back, raising hand. Miss Brooks. Children's 5-12. You can see Miss Brooks in the back. Now that y'all told me how God is good in your life. Now that y'all know what time it is. I know what time it is. In fact, it's time to give. Here at Impact, we are progressive givers. We give a minimum of 10% to our very best. We give because God gave to us and His Son Jesus Christ His very best. Now it's our time to give into this local ministry to advance of His kingdom. What I like about Impact is when you come in giving. You come in giving your praise. You come in giving your worship. And at the end of the service, you actually give and give in abundance. Yeah. And give. Just not give, just give in abundance. But the Lord gave you the opportunity to give, so we can give to Him. All right? Let us pray. Father God, we thank you. We thank you for the opportunity to give. And we give, Father, we're going to give out of love. We're going to give generously. We're going to give cheerfully. Because we know in your word it says you love a cheerful giver. Father God, we're going to give because you gave for us in your very best, Jesus Christ. And that's the ultimate sacrifice. Now we can give into this loving ministry for you and for you only in your kingdom. Bless those that have the opportunity to give, but bless those that don't have anything to give, but we still bless them anyway in their number. These things we ask in your Son Jesus' name. Amen.
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 grateful to be here celebrating Christ at our level 15 service. We celebrated Christ at our 9 a.m. This morning. We preached from Exodus 14, and we talked about watching God do His work, that if you stand still, you can watch God do only what God knows how to do, and that's be God. I did explain to them, as I will share with you, and for those who may be on live stream, I have been fighting. I felt my body fighting all week, but Friday is when, and it just really hit me. And Saturday, man, I was down. I even missed a funeral that I was supposed to attend. And so this morning, I feel a little better. I don't feel like a bowling ball is on my head, but I still carry a softball. And I told them the lights all is mic down. And y'all, I love them, all those people in the corner that work with me. That they talk to me sometimes, you see, throughout the service, making sure that I'm on target to do whatever. But they're some criminals sometimes. They all sitting over there with the mask on. They just pulling them out. Look, she got one right there. Anytime I call, they got a whole can of lights on. Passing like that. I can't believe that. Nothing but criminals. I love them. I love them. I mean, they all over there too. Find somewhere else to sit. No, I'm just kidding. I appreciate that. I found that was hilarious to me. And so I was all excited this week about preaching two different messages for the services. I'm still excited. The energy is not exactly the same. But by the strength of the Lord, man, we'll still walk out with a powerful, encouraging message that will change our lives. Now, I saw this brother stand up with his family, and I heard Minister Kimbrough say they've been asking for a year. We call him the UPS, our UPS man. He delivers your hand, man. He delivers all our packages every week to the church office. Showing up, boy, I tell you. We're going to have to leave you until. Maybe we can't pay you. We'll give you a bottle of water. It's good to see you. My buddy Damon in the back, man. Good to see you, brother. Listen, I want to get right to this passage without holding you too long. And I will share this with you, that when service is over, I'm already saying hi to y'all, and I'm saying bye to y'all, because I'm going to run right out the door. You don't want whatever it is I have, that I will be taking a bunch of my equipment for tonight, okay? You stay safe and away from me, and hi, and bye. All right, here's what we want to do. When we looked at the passage this morning, the title of that message was Watch Me Work, which is when God took Israel out of captivity and brought them to the Red Sea. We dealt with that this morning. To catapult from that, God is still in the miracle working business. The question is, when He is performing or will perform whatever miracle in your life, it does not come at times without tragic obstacles. The question is, before God performs the miracle, can you stay faithful to Him? And while you staying faithful, can you believe God to do what you didn't think could be done. So I want to look at this passage from Daniel chapter 3, verses 13 through 17. Daniel chapter 3. Daniel chapter 3, verses 13 through 17. Sister Pitts, it's good to see you. You just as cute and adorable. Daniel. Look at Brother Pitts now. That's my wife, right? Daniel. Daniel chapter 3, verses 13 through 17. What you have it signify by saying amen.
Amen.
Be reading to you from the ESV, which is simply the English Standard Version of the Bible. Then Nebuchadnezzar, in furious rage, commanded that Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego be brought. So they brought these men before the king, and Nebuchadnezzar answered and said to them, "Is it true, O Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, that you do not serve my gods or worship the golden image that I have set up? Now, if you are ready when you hear the sound of the horn, pipe, lyre, trigon, harp, bagpipe, and every kind of music, to fall down and worship the image that I have made, well and good. But if you do not worship, you shall immediately be cast into a burning fiery furnace. And who is the God who will deliver you out of my hands? Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego answered and said to the king, O Nebuchadnezzar, we have no need to answer you in this matter. If it be so, our God whom we serve is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace, and he will deliver us out of your hand, O king. This morning, for a different thought, as we catapult off this morning, I want to talk from this thought. You can throw me in because I'm not giving in. You may be seated. You can throw me in because I'm not giving in. You can throw me in because I'm not giving in. Here's one real sign that we can tell that our worship is for real. Is that when no matter what life brings our way, we stand steadfast in the ways of the Lord.
That's right. That's right.
If we were to be honest this morning, life has a way of presenting us with certain circumstances that can cause us to waver in our worship. Has anybody in here ever been so downtrodden that you didn't even want to go to church no more? Has anybody ever been so heartbroken that you begin to question God and his relevancy and if he's really able to do what the Bible says he's able to do? Can anybody in here be honest this morning if you're just not too holy and over the top to say sometimes you struggle with God's strategy? If you were to be honest this morning, that some of us have faced tribulations. Some of us have run into turbulence by which Satan has attempted to use those moments in our lives to drift us from the God that we say we serve. As a matter of fact, would anybody in here be so blatantly and cruelly honest to say that when you look at other folk, it seems like their lives are a little bit better than yours, and they're not even serving the same God you serve? Can anybody be honest in here this morning and say, God, listen, I just heard the miners say that he'd keep you in perfect peace, but why is my mind going crazy? God, I hear you say that the cattle on 1,000 hills belong to you, the silver and the gold, then why am I broke? God, I hear that you say that you can do all things, but it don't seem like you're doing nothing for me. Can anybody just be that honest this morning and say, God, I don't know what you're doing, but sometimes it's just a struggle following you. But then there are those of us who have now come to the place and point of our lives where it really don't matter what happens, because we look at God's track record and we can recall that it didn't matter whether we did good or bad, God still delivered us. It didn't matter whether we did all the right things, God still delivered us. It really didn't matter how we thought about certain things, God still delivered us. And we got to a place in our lives that we are going to serve him no matter what. There's somebody in here other than me that has decided that life is going to present you with struggles, whether you're saved or unsaved, and so you might as well have the Savior in the midst of your storm. Somebody in here other than me has already had it made up in their mind that, God, I'm going to worship you all the days of my life, and it does not matter what life presents to me, I refuse to bow down to what the world's options present me, because I know ultimately the end is death and destruction. Some of you will be honest this morning and say, I've already tried the world's way and the world has led me nowhere. But how many of you know it don't really matter what side of the fence you're on, whether you're rich or poor, whether you're black or white, whether you're short or tall, struggles will come your way. The question is, watch this, is your worship for real? I'm glad you asked, Pastor, what do you mean by worship? What I mean by worship is not just you coming to church on Sunday, not just you coming to Bible study when it's offered, but is your heart aimed at pleasing the Lord? I know we all fall short of the glory. That's not what I'm talking about. What I'm talking about is I have an aim and a heart that's solid and solidified in Christ Jesus, and I am living in his righteousness, and my worship says I present myself as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto the Lord, that even when I don't do what I should do, I still realize I belong to him. It makes all the difference in the world when you recognize when life comes at you full speed, it's always about trying to redirect your worship. See, most of us who come to church are already leaving out facing a world that questions the validity of your Jesus. There you go again, worshiping the white man's Jesus. There you go again, getting caught up in religion. But when you really grow in depth of relationship, you know it has nothing to do with a white Jesus, nothing to do with the term Christianity. It's about whether my worship to the one true God is for real, and my faith is in Christ that saves my soul, and I recognize that because nobody can do me like Jesus, it doesn't matter what some knucklehead says to me, I am solid. So watch this. When I have no money, I still worship. I will not, and I cannot afford
to allow my worship to be minimized by the magnifying of my worrying. Because when I worry about what it looks like, I begin to minimize my worship. And if I'm not careful, I'll find myself bowing down to something that has nothing to do with my salvation. Nebuchadnezzar in the passage, who is now the king of Babylon. Nebuchadnezzar had the longest and most powerful reign of the monarch of the Neo-Babylonian Empire. Nebuchadnezzar was known to be a cruel king, an evil king. Even times in the passages when you read further in Daniel, he even lost his mind because God did something with him. Nebuchadnezzar was often used by Satan. Nebuchadnezzar was the most powerful man in the world, but did not know the gods of Israel. Did not know the God of Israel, because here you see in the passage where he has a conversation with three men who are over the provinces that he placed them over. And now there is a congregation full of people. And Nebuchadnezzar says, when the music begins to play, I need everybody to bow down to that which I have set up. Because your gods no longer matter, because I am your king, because I am the one that's running the show. This golden image in which I have placed before you, when you hear the bagpipes, when you hear the lyre, you bow down and you begin to worship. Oddly enough, these three men, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, did not bow. Read the passage for yourself. There was a Chaldean who had some jealousy in his heart. Notice that these three brothers, cold-blooded, did not bow down to the wishes of the king to serve pagan gods. Even though the names Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were Babylonian pagan names. The original names were not Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. But watch this, it did not matter what they called them, they still did not change their worship. Can I help somebody real quick? Here's a tweetable moment for you, Facebook it, put it in your pocket, take it home, do whatever you want to with it. People can call you by whatever name they want, but only you can change your character. Somebody missed that. They were calling them by a name that was not given to them, but the fact they did not bow down to worship, they did not change their character, even though they were being called someone they were not. Listen, it doesn't matter what the world calls you. It doesn't matter what someone says about you. Don't you change your character. Don't you give in to what people call you. Know who you are. Know who you belong to. And know that the Lord is on your side. I am a child of God. Anybody, wait a minute. Let me pause real quick before I give you point one. Let me hang out there for just a second. Has anybody ever been in a position in your life where somebody that called you everything but a child of God? No, maybe this side kid. Is anybody over here? You've been there before and they had everything to say about you, called you out your name. Nobody over here. Is there one person over here? But watch this. It ain't what they call you. It's what you were. Thank you. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. It don't matter that you're calling me by using influences to get you to bow, to convince you your name ain't saint but sinner. Mm-hmm. Try to convince you that your name ain't holy, it's unholy. Mm-hmm. Try to convince you that you're not good enough. Try to convince you you're not the head, you're the tail. Try to convince you you're the loser and not the winner. He wants to deflate you so that you can bow to a name that don't even fit you. And when they did not bow, watch this. Verse 14 says, Nebuchadnezzar answered after the child being brought them to Nebuchadnezzar. He said this. He asked the question. Is it true, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, that you do not serve my gods or worship the golden image I set up for you? Is it true that you're defying me? Here's your first point. Here it is. Don't let critical questions influence your facts. We can hang out all day. I ain't got nowhere to go. I don't feel good no way. Here, let me give it to you one more time. Don't let critical questions influence your facts. Nebuchadnezzar asked a question to try to threaten their influence from who they knew about who they were and who they served. He asked the question, is it true? Because I want to know so I can have a reason to bring the hammer down on you. Don't you let life question what you know about God. Don't you let circumstances cause you to question what you know about the Lord. Somebody in here, if you were to be honest, I need you to look back over your life and see what God has done. And there have been many times in your life that Satan has used circumstances to cause you to question what you already. Anybody ever been there before where you really, listen, you knew what you knew what you knew, but there was somebody asked you, you said, well, wait a minute, I thought, and you began to question what you actually knew. Don't you let critical questions challenge the facts that you have. Listen, you can't tell me God ain't a way maker. I've seen it too many times before. Just because I run into a wall don't mean he can't make a way. Listen, I know him to be a healer. Just because I get sick don't mean he can't do it. Listen, I know God puts bread on my table even though I don't have all the money in the world. I know what I know, and you can change my mind. Does anybody in here know what I'm talking about? Does anybody know that you know that you know? Is there any worshipers in here that know that you know that you know? That because God didn't do what they Nebuchadnezzar asked a critical question, but they knew the facts. Because they said to him, in verse 15, after he said, now, when you're ready, with the music playing, go ahead and bow down. He said, but if you don't, be ready to be thrown into the fiery, burning furnace. And then he asked the question, who is the God that will deliver you out of my hand? So the first thing is, don't let critical questions influence your facts. But the other thing is, don't let petty or paramount pressures influence your worship. They still didn't bow. Don't let petty or paramount pressures influence your worship. Listen, there's some people, God bless their soul, but if it rains too much, they complain. Instead of saying, thank you, Lord, for the water, you complaining that it's raining. Listen, there are some people who have attitudes with God because you got arthritis, but somebody else is dying. There are people who get turned off because somebody didn't say something that they wanted to hear in church, or the pastor didn't acknowledge them, so they don't want to come back to worship service because now you are attitudinal because of something petty. But then we let some stuff get to us that rocks our world. Mama dies, daddy dies, and you talking about you can't go on. No child of God should ever say, I can't go on. It don't matter who dies. It don't matter who comes in your life and who goes. It doesn't matter how much money you have and how much you don't. That your worship, when it's for real, it doesn't matter how big the problem or how small the problem. Your worship is greater than any circumstance that you can go through. And when it becomes that, you can say, oh, magnify the Lord with me. That's when you can say, I will bless the Lord at all times, and his praise shall continually be in my mouth. It can't continually be in your mouth if you only base your worship based on how good you're doing. God don't need people worshiping him when it's all good. Worship him regardless of what life looks like. And somebody in here this morning needs to say, I need to stop giving in to the pressures of life and get myself back on track to worship, because I realize what God has done for me, at least I can do is give my life back to him. It doesn't matter how petty or how paramount. Don't let nothing influence your worship. But then in 16, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego answered and said to the king, O Nebuchadnezzar, we ain't got nothing to say to you. Matter of fact, Nebuchadnezzar said, now, who is the God, read it, lowercase g, that will deliver you from my hand? And Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego said, we ain't got nothing to say to you. Who are you that we should answer concerning our God?
Yes.
Third point, I promise I'm almost done. I really ain't feeling good, but it's cool. Here it is. Don't let people test you. Let them test your God. Can I talk to one child of God in here? Can I talk to the folk who ever had some issues on your job, and they thought they was picking at you, but what they didn't realize they was picking with somebody with the anointing on their mind? Can I talk to somebody that's been through some stuff, and when they thought they was challenging you, you said to them, touch not my anointing? Y'all ain't with me. Listen, sometimes folk gotta realize it ain't you who Has anybody ever had an enemy before? Yeah. And your enemy, y'all know what a boomerang is, don't you? Yeah. Where they throw something, yeah, but it come right back. Yeah. Anybody ever had that experience before? When God knows how to lay out before the presence of your enemies a table, yeah, spread a blessing, yeah, in your life, and they thought they was doing you harm, but they was actually setting you up. Yeah. Ain't nobody ever been there. I don't know about you, but every now and again I gotta tell you, folks, I know you think you cussing me out. Yeah. I know you think you talking bad about me, but see, I know I ain't did nothing to you. Listen, y'all, don't think past is bad. Don't think past is bad. I ain't bad. I love Jesus. I promise, Jackie, I do. But I don't care if it's another 6-year-old or 11-year-old. That's one of my child. Because the second my child can't defend herself. He says, we ain't got nothing to say to you. Who are you that we should answer? The Bible says the Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego say, if you throw us in the fire, and if it be true, the God whom we serve is able to deliver us. I need you to see, Cassandra. I need you to see the picture that he paints. The writer says, from the burning, fiery furnace. If it's burning, ain't it fiery? If it's fiery, ain't it burning? And if it's a furnace, ain't it hot? He's trying to let you know how bad that is. If you put me in the worst of the situations, my God is able to deliver me when bad gets bad, worse gets worse, and worse gets worse. He deliver us out of your hand. And Nebuchadnezzar had an attitude because, let's say, do what you want to do. Here's your last point, and we go. Don't let attitudinal people cause you to forget God is able. That's your last point. Don't let attitudinal people cause you to forget God is able. Folk have a way of counting you out when God is still counting you in. Anybody know what I'm talking about? See, listen, attitudinal people ain't always the people that's loud, fussing, and cussing. Sometimes attitudinal people are just pessimistic. Y'all, they ain't feeling, Joe Man, they ain't feeling. Watch this. There's some people that say you can't own that building across the street. There's some people that say its impact may never make it. There's some people that say you will never do well in your profession. There's some people that say what is God going to do with you and your life is a mess. There's some people that look at your past and can never see where you are presently because they don't have the foresight God gave you to see where you're on your way to. Now, and the Bible says, when Nebuchadnezzar looked, wait a minute, I need to talk to some folk who won't mind being thrown in here.
Ah!
they bowing down. Because they really don't believe God is able. There were folk who said you could never have your own business because you a mess. But look at you now. There are people who said your marriage could never make it. But look at you now. I'm not giving up. You can throw me in. But it's safer for you than I stay out. But if you be so bold and candid to put my God to the test, I'm like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. I ain't got nothing to say to you. Do what you please. Just as Jesus told Judas, whatever you do, do it quick. You're here this morning and you want to give your life to Jesus Christ. You're not saved, but you want to give your life to Christ. Say, Pastor, I'm not baptized. I haven't accepted Jesus as my Lord and Savior, but right now, I want to give my life to the Lord. Raise your hand. You want to give your life to Christ? Raise your hand. Raise it so that we can see it if you want to give your life to Jesus. You want to give your life to Jesus, raise your hand. Here's our other call. We have two calls. One is for salvation. The other is this. You already know the Lord. You are already saved. You already have an experience with Jesus Christ. But you don't have a place of worship. You don't have an assembly where you can be discipled, where you can grow. If you're here this morning and you're ready to connect to Impact Church, we want to give you a connection card. Raise your hand. Come on, right now. You're here. You're ready to connect. You're ready to connect. You're ready to connect right now. Come on, raise your hand. Don't you leave today without making that connection. You want to give your life to Christ, or you're ready to connect to make Impact Church your place of worship? Come on, raise your hand. This is one of the most important moments of your life. Stop being bogged down by the pressures. Don't bow to this world. Make your commitment right now, today. Come on, raise your hand. You want to be saved, or you're ready to connect to Impact Church? Raise your hand right now. Right now. Don't let this moment pass you by. Right now. Right now. You're saying, I'm sitting on the edge of my seat, Pastor. I know you're talking to me. I'm just nervous. You don't have to be. It's a personal thing between you and the Lord, and all we want to do is celebrate you. Come on, raise your hand and raise it right now. Don't leave today without raising your hand. I want to give you 10 more seconds to make the best decision of your life. Come on. Raise it high so ideas can hand you a card. Fill it out and drop it off in the door on the way out. Come on, raise it now. Come on, let's bless the Lord. Come on, let's bless God. Right behind us. Please see it.
Jesus. And we'll be right back after this brief commercial break.
This Tuesday. Now it was packed last week, so we'll try to bring more chairs to accommodate for you this week.
And so Brain Company, they don't have to go to the belong to the church to do anything that we do. We open everything up to everyone who's able to be there. So we want you to be at Bible study. Last thing, when you leave out and you give your tithes and your offering, don't forget, we said here at Impact, this year we're starting off right. We're tithing, we're giving the Lord no less than a tenth of our gross income. That's what we see. Grow, not net, not what I bring home. Government takes off your gross. And the government, I did nothing for me. The Lord is my keeper. You're like, I don't know what gross is. You make $50,000 in a year, the church gets $5,000. That's what that means. But after taxes, I don't know how I'm going to make it. Listen, tithing is about faith.
Yeah.
That I trust God to give, that he'll take care of me. I say it all the time. If you give him the 10th, at least, if you walk away with 90, that 90 can be like 110.
Right.
Or you can keep the 100 and it's like a penny with a hole in it. So when I give, I'm giving out of faith. And when I give or when I swipe my card with Jen, say thank you, Lord, that you allow me to give and I hold nothing back, because you held nothing back for me by giving me Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Let's step to our feet. Listen, if you walk out of here today encouraged, you walk out of here today saying, God, I will worship you regardless, and nothing will change my mind, not a circumstance nor a person, but I have my faith built on you. Amen. Church, let's pray together. Father, we thank you. We thank you for the narrative of these three men who were bold enough to face evil in the eye and say, no, we serve the Lord. So, Father, give us that same courage this week as we go to work, we go to school, we deal with family, we deal with friends. Encourage our hearts, God, to remain steadfast, faithful, and unmovable. And, Lord, we ask that you keep on blessing us and sharing your grace and mercy. Now, Lord, help us to increase and abound in love to one another and to all men, just as your Son Jesus has done unto us. That at the coming of the day, we shall stand before him, and he shall say unto us, well done, thy good and faithful servant. And all the hearts of God's children said together, amen.